to Conowingo Baptist Church, and it is so good to see everyone here this morning, and I thank you for coming out to worship with us today. We do have some announcements here. First, we have the Deacon of the Week. The Deacon of the Week is Mr. Raymond McKinney, and he is back there in the hot pink shirt. He is here for you, so the Deacon of the Week is just that person that can be there to pray for you. If you have any needs throughout the week, he's the go-to person, so you can just call the church if you have a need, and then they will get in touch with the Deacon of the Week, and I know he'd be glad to help you out. On Wednesday evenings at 6 o'clock, we've got God's Girls. That's like elementary school age girls that want to come in and sing, so they can be there through middle school. 6 o'clock, you come in, and they get a chance to sing, and sometimes they get to sing during the service as well. And then at 6:30 to 7:30, we have our adult choir practice, and so you're welcome to come out if you would like to and have the gift of singing. I want to emphasize that as well. If you want to, and if you have the gift, come on out and sing in the adult choir. And then we have the prayer meeting from 7:30 to 8:30. We meet right over there. We do our prayer meeting, and we do a Bible study. And we're going through all the prophets in Scripture, every one of them. And so we're finishing up with Malachi, and then we'll go into the New Testament prophets here soon. And then from 6:30, so that's for the adult stuff. And then if you look on there, 6:30 to 8:30, that whole block of time, we've got kids time and we've got student meetings. So high schoolers, middle school, elementary school kids, that whole time, we'll have something for them as well. So Wednesday evening, come out. It's a great time. It's a very, very healthy group of kids on Wednesday nights, and definitely would love to have you here for prayer meeting as well and choir practice. On Thursdays, we have a college and career ministry where they come in at 6:30, from about 6:30 to 9, in that kind of 18 to 25-ish age group. They come out, they play games, they have snacks, and they do a very in-depth Bible study as well. And so please, if you know anybody in that age group, if you are in that age group, come on out and enjoy that time. It certainly will help you grow as well. Now this Saturday, we have a community outreach program we're going to be doing. It's called Life Imprisonment. And we're going to be meeting over at the Cecil Bank. It'll probably go around 12:30 is when they close. It's going to be over here at Cecil Bank, and we've got a few speakers that are going to be coming up, essentially talking about the process of being arrested, the process of actually being in the jail, and we'll have somebody talk about that. We're going to have somebody that's been in jail and they've gotten out, so an actual inmate that wants to share his testimony. And then, of course, we're going to share the gospel after that. And so we're going to be meeting right over there today, right after the service. We're going to have a meeting about, you know, just kind of getting all the final little pieces together. And so if you're interested in this, right after the service, we're going to be meeting. We'll probably just meet right in here, huh? It's the easiest place. So we'll just meet in here once everybody kind of clears out, and we'll have that discussion on what this event's going to be. You can be there praying. You can be there actually at the event, just kind of supporting for the other people that show up. But this is something that we're hoping God uses to get the gospel out, and we know that God will be glorified in that. All right, so there's Monday, there's going to be a deacon meeting at 7 p.m., and then next Saturday, May 9th, is going to be a ladies' tea, and the cost for that is $5 per ticket, and the tickets are with Miss Tina Hicks, and Miss Tina wanted to share a few words about that.
Right now, we have a little over 30 ladies that are coming, so if you have not got your ticket yet, please do so today. We'll be selling tickets through next Sunday is the cutoff, okay? I have asked some ladies, we're doing a little bit different this year, to bring in their china. So if you are a lady who has some china that we can borrow, please have it here next Sunday. A few ladies that I've asked personally, but I'm sure that there's more out there. So if you have some that you don't mind us borrowing, please have it next Sunday so we make sure we have enough for everyone. I also need some men volunteers. I'm not going to put you on the spot right now, but Pastor is a great dishwasher. Him and Alan mastered it last year, okay? We're going to need to make this a special day for our wives, our daughters, our mothers. come and help. We need some dishwashers, we need a couple waiters. So if you're interested in that and you give us some time on Saturday, come down here after the service and let me know so we can see who we got and who we need. Okay? Thanks.
Thank you. The dishwashing is easy because the cups are little. But yeah, definitely want you to come in and hang out with us for the ladies' tea. The Annie Armstrong Easter offering, as you know, our goal was $2,500. Last week we went over our goal, and so we're at $2,620, which we praise God for that. And thank you very much for your giving act. The Annie Armstrong Easter offering is specifically for missionaries right here in North America. So they spread the gospel right here in our neighborhoods, literally in our towns. And so that's what that's for, and we're very thankful for that. We have some special prayer requests and special prayer needs. Today at the end of the service, first of all, we're very thankful to have Mrs. Jean Walter here this morning and able to come out, normally a homebound member, and so it's good to see you here today. And at the end of the service, as you've known, we've been talking about how we've been praying for her hip and praying for all these procedures to go well. At the end of the service today, after we do the invitation and everything, I'm going to make a special altar call for anybody that would like to come up and to get around her and to lay hands on her as we pray that God would heal her and give her the strength that she will need. Okay, so we'll do that at the end of the service, and sort of as the service is going on, just prepare your heart and prepare your spirit to answer in the way that God would have you answer for that. And so we want to do that. Today actually is our homebound member day that we're praying for. So today we're remembering all these members of our church that are either too sick or just physically they can't come out. That's Miss Helen Ayers, Miss Helen Montgomery, Miss Esther Perry, Miss Vera Taylor, and our own Jean Walter here today. We have some requests that I've heard today. Miss Ruth Johnson, if you know Miss Ruth Johnson. She has had an incident this past week with her blood sugar, and it was very alarming. She's at home now, and she's okay, but just be in prayer for her as she recovers from that. And, of course, that's Miss Debbie's mom. And we also want to remember a gentleman named Chris, who works down at the Conamingo Pizza Place. He's recently had a procedure. He's had some complications, though, this morning, and he's in the ER. And so we want to pray for him, remember him during that time. I do want to give a praise. This past week we had, for the Rising Sun High School, they had their prom, and we had some students that asked us to do an after prom party here at the church. And so down in the fellowship hall, we had music, we had games, you know, we had Foursquare and all this other great stuff. But we also had an opportunity to share the gospel and to just give Jesus' own words about the kingdom of God. And so we did not waste that opportunity to have children here. And so I praise God for that opportunity, and I also praise God for all the college kids we had. We had a ton of college kids that came. Lancaster Bible College, we had some from our own group here. They came out that night and they hung out with these high school kids just to give them a safe place and a safe alternative on that prom night, so they're not out making mistakes that they will regret possibly for their life. And so thank you for everybody that helped out with that. Thank you for all those that prayed about this event. And I'm very thankful for the turnout that God had for that as well. And somehow it got cleaned up, so we're thankful for that too. But are there any other requests, any new requests that you want to share this morning, or any praises that you have to God for something he's done recently in your life?
Have to
Yeah, you keep jamming that finger too. Keep going on the trampoline, you'll jump it out. Any others? Any other prayer requests or praises you'd like to share this morning?
If I don't embarrass my friend, I invited my neighbor, Miss Myra. She has ministered such to me this morning. I had the worst migraine when I woke up. And I just felt so convicted, though, to still come. And she had all of the accoutrements for taking care of a migraine that I've ever met a woman have. And I thought, what a blessing that I was just going to let the enemy win that battle and not come to church. And yet, I'm thinking I'm going to be helping minister to somebody by bringing them. And yet, God, in His mercy, has Miss Myra, Myra, ministering to me as a neighbor much more than. So God's just always just gives more to you than you could ever think. And I just am praising God this morning for this wonderful neighbor that I have. And I'm so glad she even drove because I was feeling so bad. So, praise God for good neighbors, good friends. She's a believer, and I'm just getting to know her better and better. God blessed me this morning.
Well, thank you. Thank you.
Officially
embarrassed,
yeah.
Officially embarrassed.
But it's glory to God.
Glory to God. Welcome to Conway, go on.
There you go.
Anybody else want to call out their neighbor?
We are all very late.
Any other prayer requests or praises this morning that you'd like to share with the church? All right. Well, at this time, if you would like to stand in recognition of any of the prayer requests that we've said, maybe you have an unspoken prayer request that you have on your heart. You can stand in recognition of that. And this morning, I know, Raymond, I know you're in the back, but could you open us up with a word of prayer this morning? Thank you.
Hello, Jack. There we go. Good morning. We had a very, very interesting morning, but praise God we're here, and we're here to worship. So, TJ, if you would, my friend, bring up How Great Is Our God. We've had all kinds of technical issues, but praise God, we got it figured out.
TJ, you don't have to run it from up there. I don't have his number.
Yeah. All right.
TJ, you're going to have to run it from up there. I don't have his number.
All right. Sure. We got the double thumbs up, so that's a good sign, right? All right, let's sing How Great Is Our God.
How great is our God. Sing with me. How great is our God. All we see. Thank you.
How great!
Now say, am I the do, Lord, have you blessed us, Lord, and kept us safe this week. Lord, I pray for each one, Lord, that everyone can test, Lord, have issues, Lord, whatever the situation, Lord, I pray you be with them, Lord, and this Lord, share them with you, Lord God. Father, dear, the ones that are not here, Lord, I pray, Lord, that you just help us, Lord, just to minister to them, Lord, and tell them what you today. Bless these tithes and offerings. Use them, the Lord, by your name. And give you all the praise and all the glory.
Amen.
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 Hamilton is in a neat city, and I think it's in a neat place.
They need to be like the city of your own.
And I always said, you know, there's going to be a church in Colville.
Anything to reach new people, I am all for it.
God kind of pretty clearly led us to a particular neighborhood.
I sold my car, and I gave my friends away, and took all the money, and I bought a plane ticket.
And all of a sudden, I said, I know I'm going to spend the rest of my life, and I know what my mission is.
I set up an entire church. If I was just to look at it, and from one point of view, I could hear you're crazy.
But every morning when you woke up, you knew that's what God wants us to
be. You're not going to reach everybody in your world at your church.
There's something exciting about doing something.
You have so many people that reject the church.
We want to change that, but here's the deal. We have to dream bigger.
And we're going to do it. We're going to do whatever we have to. We'll sell our house, get another job, help us work.
Whatever it takes, how are we missing the nation of this world?
But we can't do it alone.
We're really excited to see the things that God's going to do.
This morning, we're going to continue this series called Email, which stands for Epistle Mail. And the epistles are the letters in the church that God inspired men to write after Christ had already died and been resurrected. Then you have Paul and a few others who wrote letters to the churches that God had inspired. And this is how you're supposed to act. This is how you're supposed to treat each other and how you're supposed to worship. And so as you're turning to Galatians chapter 6, today's message is called Sharing is Caring. And I know we've all heard that term, and we're going to see it in Scripture today. Sharing is caring. And so if you wouldn't mind, please stand at the reading of God's Word, Galatians chapter 6, and we're going to read 1 through 16 of that chapter. So it says, starting verse 1, brothers, if someone is caught in any wrongdoing, you who are spiritual should restore such a person with a gentle spirit, watching out for yourselves so you also won't be tempted. Carry one another's burdens. In this way, you will fulfill the law of Christ. For if anyone considers himself to be something when he is nothing, he deceives himself. But each person should examine his own work, and then he will have a reason for boasting in himself alone, and not in respect to someone else. For each person will have to carry his own load. The one who is taught the message must share all his good things with the teacher. Don't be deceived. God is not mocked. For whatever a man sows, he will also reap, because the one who sows to his flesh will reap corruption from the flesh. But the one who sows to the Spirit will reap eternal life from the Spirit. So we must not get tired of doing good, for we will reap at the proper time if we don't give up. Therefore, as we have opportunity, we must work for the good of all, especially for those who belong to the household of faith. Look at what large letters I use as I write to you in my own handwriting. Those who want to make a good impression in the flesh are the ones who would compel you to be circumcised. but only to avoid being persecuted for the cross of Christ. For even the circumcised don't keep the law themselves, however, they want you to be circumcised in order to boast about your flesh. But as for me, I will never boast about anything except the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ. The world has been crucified to me through the cross, and I to the world. For both circumcision and uncircumcision mean nothing. What matters instead is a new creation. May peace come to all those who follow this standard, and mercy to the Israel of God. Let's pray. Father God, thank you so much for your word. Father, thank you that in your word we can see the principle of sharing and how we are to do it in a way that honors you. Father, please be with the message today. Please bless this entire time as we worship through the preaching of your word. And God, if there are any here today who do not know you as their personal Lord and Savior, I pray that your word would speak right to them, right to their soul, that they would recognize that they are separated from you and that you love them and want to be close to them. Father, we love you and praise you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
The first section we're going to look at today is sharing burdens. Sharing burdens. We see this in verse 1. Brothers, if someone is caught in any wrongdoing, you who are spiritual should restore such a person with a gentle spirit, watching out for yourselves so you also won't be tempted. So this idea of sharing burdens that we're going to look at, it says if someone is caught in any wrongdoing, we as a church are intended to hold each other accountable. We as a church are intended to point and see and recognize sin in our brothers and sisters, and believe it or not, we are supposed to call it out. We're supposed to go to the people gently and let them know, hey, you are living in sin. Now, what would your response be if a brother or sister in Christ came to you flat out and said, hey, I see this sin that you are committing in your life. I see that you are not repenting. You're not turning from it. You're living in it, and you really don't seem to care. If a brother or sister in Christ came to you personally and called out that sin personally, how would you respond? I think most of us would initially run off the bat and say, well, I know some things about you too. You don't walk out of water. But church, this is what we're supposed to do. The reason that I believe that the church is so comfortable with these little hidden sins is because we don't call it out. We see it in other people. It's not like they're hiding it. Right, they think they are, but we see what's going on. You've got close friends who are in the church. You know exactly what they're struggling with. But we're afraid to call it out because what if they talk about my sin? The scriptures say the opposite. For when you and I confess our sins one to another, now we've got nothing to hide. Now we can take off the mask of hypocrisy and say, no, I'm not going to be a hypocrite. This is who I am. This is what I struggle with. And I need help. It's not our responsibility to nitpick about worldly things. I want to make that very clear. So if you've got a clothing issue with somebody, if you've got a sense of style, you're like, I cannot believe they wear that. It's after Labor Day. If you just don't like someone's personality, that's not what we're talking about. That's your problem. That's not their problem. You disagree with the way somebody is, that's your problem. That's not their problem. You don't like the way somebody dresses, that's your problem. This says that they're caught in a wrongdoing. That is a sin. So, if someone's caught in a wrongdoing, you who are spiritual should restore. Now, this is not spiritual in the sense that the whole world uses this word. Everybody and their mama, you go talk to them, they say, I'm a very spiritual person. Do you believe Jesus died for you and that's the only way? No. Everything leads to the same. I'm spiritual. not talking about that. The spiritual, as it means right here, is those who are mature in Christ. Those who understand who Jesus is, they have a close relationship with him. It says those who are spiritual should restore such a person with a gentle spirit. It's to their face. To their face. If you had heard that someone is sinning, if you had heard that somebody is living in sin, that's not your responsibility to go, first of all, and go talk behind their back. That's never your responsibility. That's gossip, and that's sin. But if you know that somebody, and you've seen somebody living in sin, it's your responsibility to call it out to that person's face. Not go to four or five other people and say, can you believe? But go to the person. Say, hey, I want to help you with a gentle spirit be restored. And it uses that word restore because the one living in sin has fallen away from the truth. Somehow in their life, with that sin, they have come to believe it's just not that big of a deal. They have fallen away from the truth. So they need to be restored to the truth. They need to be brought back to what God would say this is what it is. Now it says, watch out so that you yourself won't be tempted. See, don't ever lie to yourself and think that you or me, that we have conquered any sin. Don't ever lie to yourself thinking you did it. Because you and I didn't do it. We were dead in our transgressions. We were dead in our sin, and we needed a Savior. So it says, watch out, so you also won't be tempted. Be careful when you go to that person who's living in that sin, because chances are they're going to say, hey, it's really not that bad. Have you actually tried it? Like, I'm doing it. It's not killing me. So it says, watch out, so you also won't be tempted. We have to watch out because Jesus won the war. Not us. So it says, verse 2, carry one another's burdens. In this way you fulfill the law of Christ. Jesus says it this way in John 13, 34. He says, I give you a new command. Love one another just as I have loved you. You must also love one another. The fulfillment of the law of Christ. The law of Christ is the same law as the Old Testament, as we saw last week. That law can be summed up in love one another as you love yourself. The law of Christ is love. So it says, carry one another's burdens, and this way you fulfill it. We saw in the previous verse, verse 1, that we are to restore others with a gentle spirit, right? Which means that that's how we deal with one another's sins. We do it with a gentle spirit. Here we go. Here it says, carry one another's burdens. This is a heart of service. And in that heart of service, we need to come and be willing to come alongside one another, gently in love, and we should care enough about the person next to you. We should care enough to be willing to carry their burdens. Well, how do we do that? Well, we don't do it by judging and condemning them. Instead, we do it by praying for them, calling them, and offering to help them. You don't call and say, I've seen what you've done, and I'm just going to tell the world. You say, no, I've seen what you've done, and I want to help you to be restored. I want to walk alongside you to get you out of this mess of sin so that you can be restored to Christ and to the church. That's what I want for you. And certainly, if you see something in me that needs to be changed, tell me so that we can work together through this. No longer hiding things. Verse 3, for if anyone considers himself to be something when he is nothing, he deceives himself. Our perspective must always remain true to the perspective of the gospel. The false perspective is that we did the work and that we deserved for God to save us. But the truth is that we were, as it says here, nothing. And we were actively rebelling against God. That's where we were. We were dead. We were nothing. So then none of us should consider ourselves something, or else we deceive ourselves. We lie to ourselves. That's why the gospel needs to go out to every group, to every nation, because we all need God the same. Every single person, every single culture, every group is just as dead as you and I were. So the gospel needs to go out to every single person. regardless of background. So verse 4 it says, but each person should examine his own work, and then he will have a reason for boasting in himself alone and not in respect to someone else. Examine his own work. Jesus puts it this way in Luke chapter 12, verse 42 to 48. It says, the Lord said, who then is the faithful and sensible manager his master will put in charge of his household servants to give them their allotted food at the proper time? That slave whose master finds him working when he comes will be rewarded. I tell you the truth, he will put him in charge of all his possessions, but if that slave says in his heart, my master is delaying in coming, and he starts to beat the male and female slaves, and to eat and drink and get drunk, that slave's master will come on a day he does not expect him, and in an hour he does not know. Look at this. He will cut him to pieces and assign him a place with the unbelievers. And that slave who knew his master's will and didn't prepare himself or do it will be severely beaten. But the one who did not know and did things deserving of blows will be beaten lightly. Much will be required of everyone who has been given much, and even more will be expected of the one who has been entrusted with more. This is the idea of examining your work. Jesus gives this whole story because he's saying, look, there are some who have been told the master's coming back, but in their hearts they say, eh, I don't know if Jesus is really coming back. I don't even know if I really believe it. So you see it in their life. They live how they want. They get drunk, they party, they treat people however they want to treat them. So Jesus says, yeah, when the master comes back, that person's getting cut to pieces and tossed with the unbelievers. That's hell. Let's make that real clear. So there's some people who sit in church, possibly their whole life, playing Jesus, playing church. They really don't believe it. They certainly don't act like it. And when it comes time, you're not going to fool Jesus. When he comes back, he's going to throw you with everybody else that lives that way and thinks that way. But then there's going to be some here who have heard, and we're just not doing what we know is to be right. We're not being obedient. To that person says, you're going to get a severe beating when the master comes back. So it's not going to be, God's not going to say, hey, great job being disobedient with the gospel your whole life. Great job with that. No, it's going to be a severe beating. And I don't know what that looks like from God Almighty, but I don't want to. But then it says those that don't really know. So they may be a new believer, we don't know, maybe they just mentally, they just can't fully understand it. And so they kind of get it, they kind of don't. They weren't really given everything they could, possibly, but either way, so that person gets like a light beating. So that person didn't take what they were supposed to, they didn't do what they were supposed to. But they knew, it was a very little, but even that, they weren't really faithful to it. This is this principle in Scripture of accountability of our work. We are, if you put your faith in Christ, you're covered by grace. You're saved. You're going to heaven. That's clear. Scripture is very clear to that. But don't think that that means that's your ticket for living in sin. God has given each of us a very respectable work for us to do for Him. He doesn't want us pointing at others. He doesn't want us saying, well, they should be doing this, or, you know, that person could be doing that. And we certainly are not supposed to associate ourselves with people who are working and saying, well, kind of in it with this guy. So they do what they're supposed to, so I guess I'm good. It says that we'll have a reason for boasting in ourselves alone and not in respect to somebody else. God wants you to do the work He's given you. He does not want you to try to do the work that you have not been given. We'll look at that here in a second. It says, for each person will have to carry his own load, verse 5. Now, how do we reconcile verse 5 with what we just read in verse 2? This says you'll have to carry your own load. Verse 2 says carry one another's load, or carry one another's burdens. So which one is it? Each person will have to carry his own load. Always being willing to help each other out, right? So you and I should be willing to share in the burdens of others. We need to be willing to go and help somebody else. But no one else can take the fall for your own personal disobedience. You understand what that's saying? So you see other people, you want to carry other people's burdens. You want to help them with their sin, help them be restored. But for you and for me, nobody is going to be able to come in on that day and be able to account for your disobedience. No one's going to be able to do that. Just you, just God. You're going to speak for the things that you're disobedient about. And you can't blame anybody. You can't put, the onus is on you. So the load here refers to the idea of a backpack. Okay, each person will have to carry his own load. It's like a backpack. It's similar to Jesus' words in Matthew 11:30, where he says, my yoke is easy and my burden, right, my backpack is light. It's the daily responsibility which God has given each of us to carry. And in comparison, it really is light. That thing that God just wants you to do, it's a light work. He says, my yoke is easy. That's being attached to the stronger animal. Okay, Jesus Christ is that strong figure who's carrying you along. And he's given you like a little backpack. He's like, okay, I'm carrying the world. Here's your backpack. Just take care of the backpack. And it's light. The things that Jesus wants us to do in comparison is very light. And so that's what he's saying. You're going to need to carry your own load. Look at that thing that God's given you and be faithful to it. So, the first conclusion today is let believers know that you are willing to share in their burdens. Let believers know that you are willing to share in their burdens. If you've never told a believer, hey, brother, sister, I want to be there for you. Like, you go through something hard, just give me a call, and I'll talk to you. If you need that presence, like, in your home, and your temptation is just becoming too much, I'll come to your house. Let them know that. Let the believers know that you're willing to share in their burdens. The second point today that we're going to look at is sharing good things. Sharing good things. We see in verse 6, the one who's taught the message must share all his good things with the teacher. Now, the principle that's being discussed directly here is that the churches and the members of the church are to ensure that your teachers are taken care of. And what does that mean? It says basically if you're coming to the church, you're learning God's word, you're hearing the preaching and enjoying the things that God has for you, it says then share your good things. It's the idea of the offering, of the tithe, of giving your gifts and sharing them with those who are in the leadership of the church. Now, if you've been here for the last 2 years, you know I don't preach on money and I don't preach on that stuff very often. But if it's in the text, I'm not going to avoid it either. All right? So this is what it says. And this is a perfect opportunity to kind of share with you when that offering plate goes around, what happens? It is funny, and I've heard it again this last week, but there are some who really believe, like, I take the offering, I just bank it. And that's what we do. We do not do that at all. When the offering plate goes around, the offering goes together. We decided at the beginning of the year as a church where we want that money to go and how much. We always give a certain amount to missions all the time. That certain amount always goes out. It's going to spread the gospel of Jesus Christ. We have stuff that goes to needy people, people in the community that need help. We do have a staff here on church, and we have a salary for us, and you can always see that in the monthly report. We're accountable to every penny that we get. All right, and then we also have bills that have to get paid for the church. The lights don't magically come on in churches, believe it or not. We have trash that gets taken out. We've got all that stuff. We've got maintenance around the building to try to make it and maintain it so it looks good. So that's where the offering goes. Your money goes directly to the kingdom of God and the way that he uses it around this area. And I wanted to make sure that I also say this church, since I've been here, has been extremely generous. That we've never been lacking. I know Amber and I, our family, is extremely well taken care of in every single way. And so this church is not hurting for that. But you might be new to the church. You may not have known that the scripture teaches that if you're learning and if a church is blessing, then you share your good things with the church as well. You may not have money. Then don't share your money if you don't have it. Maybe you've got a talent for hammering things. Maybe you've got a talent for making flowers and things like that. That's sharing your good things with your church. All right, so moving along. Verse 7 and 8, it says, don't be deceived. God is not mocked, for whatever a man sows, he will also reap, because the one who sows to his flesh will reap corruption from the flesh, but the one who sows to the Spirit will reap eternal life from the Spirit. So again, it says, do not be deceived. Don't lie to yourselves. This time adding that God is not mocked. That idea of being mocked is turning your nose up to God. Well, how in the world do we turn our nose up to God with the way that we spend our money? It says, whatever a man sows, he will also reap. So then, we may be mocking God with where our money is spent, where our money is sown. So if we sow flesh, in other words, if we're spending money for our worldly desires, we're going to reap flesh. We're going to reap worldly death. If we sow spirit, those who are spending our money in a way that honors God, we're going to reap spirit. That's godly eternal life. So just to clarify, can you pay your way into heaven? Collectively, let's say no. Can you pay your way into heaven?
No.
Okay. But you can waste your time investing and worldly desires. The Bible calls that corruption from the flesh. Corruption is decay. We can physically break ourselves down when we give in to sin and we pay for it. That's why this passage speaks in terms of planting and harvesting. You and I have either been cultivating one garden or the other. You are planting and cultivating one garden in your life or the other. In your life, are you planting your ambitions? Are you watering it with your goals? And are you trimming it according to your wants? Or are you planting God's word in your life? Are you watering it with His will? And are you trimming it with His church? Sowing to the flesh or sowing to the Spirit? Harvesting death or harvesting eternal life? Verse 9, so we must not get tired of doing good, for we will reap at the proper time if we don't give up. This is a word on endurance. We must not get tired, we must not give up. Don't get tired of studying your Bible. Don't get tired of waking up on a Sunday morning. Don't get tired of praying to God. And don't give up on our Lord Jesus Christ, as He will never give up on you. But see, the devil would love to book your next vacation from God's Word. He would be happy to do that for you. And he'll tell you why, too. He'll say things to you like this. Take a break. Miss that prayer meeting on Wednesday night. Don't let VBS get in the way of your summer vacation. You've earned it. No, we haven't. We've earned death. We earned hell, remember? That's why Jesus came from heaven. To watch for us and watch out for us. To save us. He had to die on the cross because of what we earned. God saved us from what we deserve. And you and I will reap eternal life if we invest in the kingdom. At the proper time in Christ, it says. So praise God then, for He alone is good. And don't get tired of doing His good works, and don't give up when you're in the middle of His good works either. So that's another thing that we could do. We could get burnt out. We could be right in the middle of doing a work that God has for us to do, and we get tempted just to quit. So this is a little bit much. Verse 10, therefore, as we have opportunity, we must work for the good of all, especially for those who belong to the household of faith. There's a therefore here at the beginning of this verse, and it's because of what was before it. Before it, it talked about endurance, enduring the things that God has. It says, therefore, as we have opportunity, we must work for the good of all. It says, as we have opportunity, it does not say beyond our opportunity. See, it's tempting all the time to look at all the things that need to get done and say, I'm going to do that. Nobody else is doing it. I'm going to do that. But this says, therefore, as we have opportunity. These are the opportunities that God has for us and not for anyone else. If you look around and you say, well, nobody's doing it, so I've got to do it. Then you pray about what that believer is in the church that should be doing. Pray about that person that has that gift and they're not doing anything. Pray about that. Because what are you supposed to do? Restore them gently. Go to that person and say, you know what? I know you have this gift, and I see that you're not really doing that here in the church, and we need it. So tell them that. But you worry about your opportunity. You worry about the things that God has for you, and don't try to do it all, or you will get burnt out trying to do everyone else's work. God gives us each particular experiences in life to glorify Him with. And Jesus, just as Jesus made His life a sacrifice for all mankind, so we must work for the good of all. Just as it says here. God expects you and I to make people's lives better. It says, especially for those in the household of faith, that's the church. You should make the people in this church, their lives should be better from knowing you. Their lives should be better from their interactions with you. When they talk with you, they should know, man, every time I go to speak to this person, I know that they're doing whatever they can to build me up in Christ. It shouldn't be, here comes that person, let me do whatever I can to not talk to them. Our hearts need to be right with one another. Do what you can to promote good things for your brothers and sisters in Christ. The second conclusion today is to share the good things from God with the people that He has placed in your life. Share the good things from God with the people He has placed in your life. And the note in that verse, especially God's church, which is the people. Final point today is sharing the cross. It says here in verse 11, look at what large letters I use as I write to you in my own handwriting. This verse is a transition for Paul as he's going to now begin writing in his own handwriting. Just like we do in our text messages, we put all caps for emphasis, right? Well, they didn't have like quotation marks, so what they would do in Greek oftentimes is they would switch to just writing bigger. Like, if I want to emphasize something, I really mean it. So that seems to be what Paul is doing here. He says, look at what large letters I'm using as I write to you. So he's kind of going to emphasize and conclude what he's been talking about through this book of Galatians. He's going to sort of conclude here in these verses. So he says, verse 12, those who want to make a good impression in the flesh are the ones who would compel you to be circumcised, but only to avoid being persecuted for the cross. It cannot be overstated that as Christians, you and I are not intended to seek the approval of people. You and I are not living our lives so that everyone will look at us and say, they are just the best. That's not how we're supposed to live. We are to do good for all people, but even that is for the sake of Christ. The good things you do for others is not for you, it's for Christ. The Bible here is teaching that anyone who adds to the gospel is trying to make a good impression in the flesh. What does that mean? You're trying to look good to other people. You want other people to see what you do and say, wow, they're just on another spiritual plane than I am. Look at all the good stuff they do. You're trying to impress people. See, there were those who were going in and saying you had to be circumcised in order to be saved. You have to receive Christ, but you also have to follow this or that, whatever. They add their own human laws to the universal law of God, which is that Jesus did it all. But in doing so, they are avoiding being persecuted for the cross of Christ. The gospel being a free gift to sinners is going to lead to persecution. People will not like you, and they will really prefer you just to be dead or gone. And think about this. Are we really better than Jesus? See, it's easy to tell people, okay, if you do this, and you do this, and you pray like this, and you light the candles, you do all these religious things, then you're going to be right with God. People love that. People love to hear that they can do it, they can look religious, and then they'll be right. They love that. What people hate to hear because of our pride, people hate to hear you can't do anything. You tell people that there's nothing they can do, they're just dead in hell, and they say, no, give me something. Give me something to do. I'll pray this way, I'll do these things, I'll memorize this. People want to know that they have a hand in it. What they hate to hear is that it's free. And that's exactly what Jesus was going around saying, I don't care how religious you are, you need me. I'm the only thing you need. So if it happened to Jesus, And like, seriously, if sharing Jesus, and we think we're going to do that and remain completely saved, when the God of the universe was crucified for it, we've lost our minds. And I'm telling you right now, the devil would want nothing more than you to keep the gospel to yourself and just tell people, hey, just go to church. Just do this thing. Do that thing. Tell them they're sinners. Do what Jesus did. Tell them flat out, they're going to die and go to hell if they don't have Christ. And you'll start to see persecution in your life. It's amazing. But it's what God did, and it's what God tells us to do. It's His gospel. And all we see in Scripture is that everyone that He taught to preach like He did, they suffered too. So it says, verse 13, for even the circumcised don't keep the law themselves. However, they want you to be circumcised in order to boast about your flesh. Here's the thing. People who don't understand the gospel will try to control you. Period. People who don't understand the gospel are going to try to control you one way or the other. Because all the gospel does is free you. When you really get it, when you really understand the gospel, you're free to live for Christ. People that don't understand the gospel are going to try to control you. That's their attempt at proving that their sense of religion is valid. If they can get you to do all the stuff that they think they have to do to earn their way. If they can make people do or say what they want, they think of themselves as something. But what does it say in verse 3 about people who think they're something? It says that person deceives themselves. They're lying. Now, why would they want you to be controlled by them? It says so they can boast about your flesh. They want to be able to brag about the physical things that they've accomplished. And so that's how you sort of know. You sort of know people who are in it for the gospel. You know it for the people who are actually doing it for the sake of Christ and not. Because those who aren't doing it for Christ are going to tell you all the things they do. They're going to have to talk about all the things they do. Because they're not doing it for the love of Jesus Christ. They're not doing it because this person was going to go to hell and now, praise God, they're saved. They did it because they want to be seen as the super, uber religious person. But it says they don't even keep the law themselves. What does that mean? Well, if we say that the law of Christ is love, then they don't do any of it in love for you or for me. The service and the acts that they are choosing to do are for them. They want to look good. They want to sound good. They're not doing it out of love. They just have to have their names all over it. Everybody needs to know, I did this thing. Verse 14 says, but as for me, I will never boast about anything except the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ. The world has been crucified to me through the cross, and I to the world. Imagine if all of our hearts echoed the passion that we see here. If all we cared about was bragging about Jesus. Imagine what the world would be like. Imagine if we shared His cross with everyone. But what about all that physical stuff we want, right? You may be thinking that. Well, Josh, I need physical things. There's things I want in my life. It says, the world has been crucified to me through the cross, and I to the world. We have identified with our Savior Jesus when we say to the stuff of the world, go ahead and nail it up, go ahead and curse it, and let it rot. Could you say that to your stuff in your life right now? I want you to picture your home. I want to picture your couch. I want you to picture your vehicles, your stuff. Could you say to your stuff, I'm nailing it, I'm cursing it, and I will let it rot. Because all I need is Jesus Christ. That's what the verse is saying. That's what it's saying. And you say, I could never get to that place. Yes, you could. And maybe you've got a Christian in your life that can help you get to that place. So you can see it's not about the stuff. Recently we've had a terrible fire here in the area, and there's a family that lost pretty much everything. And through those who are helping them and surrounding them and helping them build their life back up, I can tell you, talk to them about their stuff. See, Jesus is so serious and so honest when he says things like this in his word. When God shows us and reveals to us, this is really the truth. If you aren't willing to lose it all, you are not worthy of following me. That's what Jesus says. It's the attachment to our stuff that keeps us locked to our couches instead of going out and talking about Jesus. It's the attachment to our stuff. We are free when we believe that Jesus truly is everything we have needed, everything we need right now, and everything that we will ever need. That provides freedom because we don't feel that we have to hold on to our stuff. Verse 15, for both circumcision and uncircumcision means nothing. What matters instead is a new creation. It really doesn't matter then what you and I do here on earth if we have not become a new creation. That's being born again. If we never experience the breakthrough from death in sin to life in Christ, then all the religious stuff in the world means nothing. That's why Jesus says in John 3:3, he says, I assure you, unless someone is born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. It is death to this world. It is death to the life that the devil would want you to believe. And it's being born again, becoming a new creation, where now you look at your life and say, wow, all I really need is Jesus. The final verse here says, may peace come to all those who follow this standard, that's the standard of Christ alone, nothing else, and mercy to the Israel of God. Peace come to the believers, the born-again Christians. We have a peace, and we have a peace that's going to come when Christ raises us again. And then it says, mercy to the Israel of God. Every time it uses this term, Israel of God, it's talking about the Jews. Yes, you and I as Gentiles will be grafted into Israel, yes. But this Israel of God, realize and remember, Paul writes this whole letter because there were Jews who were coming in saying you have to be crucified, or you have to be circumcised, you have to follow the law in order to be saved. So Paul turns right around, he tells the Jews, man, mercy to you. I hope that you get it. I hope that God gives you the mercy to live long enough to recognize you don't need all that religious stuff. You only need Jesus. He's gently correcting them and encouraging them and praying, God, show them mercy. Think about that one in your life that you think they'll never believe. Pray that God would have mercy on them, that they would. The final concluding point is that we need to share the cross of Jesus so that you never forget what Jesus shared with you. You share the cross of Jesus so that you will never forget what Jesus shared with you. At this time, we're going to have an invitation. What that means is if you're sitting here today and you do not have Jesus as your personal Lord and Savior, and you know it, and you look at your life, you say, yeah, I've been planting that garden for myself. I really have not been planting anything for the kingdom of God. If you are not saved, we want to invite you to come forward. If you've been saved and you've not been baptized, you've not gotten completely under the water, completely out of the water. That's what the word baptized means. It means immersion, completely under. Just like God, when he came down as Jesus, completely died, he was completely dead. Just like you and I, we identify with that. We are completely dead to sin. And when they come out of the water, it's a picture of Christ coming back from the dead, saying, I identify with that because I've been born again. If that's you, I want to invite you to come forward. And finally, if this is the church God has for you in your life, if this is the church God has brought you, and he's shown you good things here, and he's told you this is the place for you, I want to invite you to come forward to be a member of this church. All I'm going to pray is that you're obedient as God does call you. We're all going to stand together, and I want to invite you to stand. We're going to pray. When I say amen, if God's calling you to come forward, you come forward. Don't think about it. You just come. Let's pray. Father God, thank you so much for your word. God, thank you that you show us a biblical principle of sharing. And it truly is caring about that other person. It's caring about your kingdom and it's loving them enough to care for them as well. Father, there may be some here today that you're going to call forward and draw forward. I pray that you do. And I just ask for courage in their heart, courage in their spirit, that, Father, you would bring them forward and let your kingdom continue to grow. In Jesus' name, amen.
Is that a leaf?
Now let's join hands and we'll sing together. We'll pray.
All right, let's join hands. Let's sing "How Great Is Our God" one more time.
How great is our God? Sing with me. How great is our God? And all will see how.